thank you very much. And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be here in Zurich and rather unexpectedly to be performing in a theatre. I didn't realise that you were asking me to appear in an opera today, but clearly that is the intent. I guess the only question, given that we are talking about the future of Europe, is how will the opera end? Will it be a wonderful chorus of peasants singing joy or people at a ball drinking champagne, or will there be bodies all over the floor? Well, I have to tell you that I fear that my lecture is going to end more, as it were, in Gotterdammerung than in Die Fledermaus. But nevertheless, I hope, well, I will suggest some of the things that we might do to make it somewhat less gloomy. It says on the agenda that I will talk about sound economic and institutional foundations for Europe, which is indeed the theme of the whole conference. But I want to start by arguing that we cannot have sound institutions and policies without sound theory. And that in order to have sound future policies, we need to challenge quite fundamentally some of the major assumptions of the pre-crisis orthodoxy. Before the crisis, I think economists and central banks had become increasingly confident that they had the answers to financial and macroeconomic stability. That as long as central banks achieved low and stable inflation, the macroeconomy would be sound, and that therefore they didn't have to pay much attention to the details of the financial system, or the level of leverage in the economy, or where credit was being used in the economy. Those were, I suggest, key features of the pre-crisis orthodoxy in relation to theory and practice. I'm going to challenge both of those assumptions and argue that it has major implications for policy, both as regards how we avoid the future crisis, the crisis of 2025 or 35 or 40, but also implications for what we have to do to navigate out of the mess, and I think it is a mess, in which past policy mistakes have left us. I'm going to start my argument with an assertion, and then I will come back to it later and try to justify it. My assertion is that the most fundamental reason why the global economy has found it so difficult to recover from the crisis of 2008 is the very big increase in private sector leverage, which had occurred not only over the previous 5 or 10 years, but over the previous 55 years. This chart shows total private domestic credit as a percent of GDP in the advanced economies. It is taken from a recent article from Carmen Reinhart and Ken Rogoff. And what it shows was that in 1950, private sector leverage in the advanced economies was 50% of GDP, and that by 2007, it had risen to 170% of GDP, with a relentless increase over the whole of that period. Now, this, I'm going to argue, is the most fundamental reason why we have found recovery from the crisis so difficult, why recovery has been so slow and weak. Now, of course, there are other reasons within the financial system itself which triggered the crisis. Things to do with the development of shadow banking, the complexity of intra-financial system links, things to do with the inner design of the financial system. But it is, I assert, once the crisis occurred, the overall level of private sector leverage which makes it so difficult to recover. Before the crisis, however, that increase in leverage rang almost no alarm bells. Indeed, I think we can say that the theoretical assumption about private sector leverage was that it was either benign or that it was entirely neutral. The benign thesis dominated within finance theory, within people who think about why we have debt and equity contracts in the economy. And the argument was that you need debt contracts in the economy because if we tried to run the economy as an all-equity economy, we would not get the mobilization of capital investment required for growth. There is, therefore, both a body of theory which talks about the useful role of non-state contingent debt contracts, the difficulties that investors, who are, if they are equity, have in verifying whether the person in whom they have invested is giving them a good return. There's a body of theory which argues we need debt contracts. And then there's a body of empirical analysis, for instance, set out in Ross Levine's sort of meta-literature study of 2004, which says when you look back through history, the more credit you have, the more that private credit to GDP increases, the more that we have growth. So there was an argument that, for instance, developing countries with a low level of private credit to GDP, such as India, 10% of GDP, would have done better if they had credit to GDP of 50%. The finance theory and the empirics and the narrative of economic history told us that financial deepening in the specific form of increasing private credit to GDP was good for growth. As for modern macroeconomic theory and central bank analysis, it had, broadly speaking, gravitated to the point of view that it could simply ignore the details of the financial system. If you look at major modern textbooks of new classical or new Keynesian economic theory and the theory of the determination of the price level, something like Michael Woodford's Interest and Prices, there really isn't a financial system in there. The financial system was largely ignored. And within major central bank models, what are called dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models, what you have is representative agent firms contracting with representative agent companies, and there really isn't a banking and financial system there. We had ended up believing that we could ignore the details of the financial system. As Mervyn King put it, the dominant new Keynesian models of monetary economics lack an account of financial intermediation so that money, credit, and banks play no meaningful role. As Olivier Blanchard put it, we assumed we could ignore much of the details of the financial system. So finance theory treated the financial system as... The financial system was thus treated by central banks and modern macro as a neutral veil through which the interest rate passed to influence the economy, but where the detailed size and structure of that financial system played no major role. As long, therefore, as central banks achieved low and stable inflation by appropriately moving the interest rates, it was assumed that all would be well in the economy and that we could ignore the level of leverage and the mix of credit. So modern monetary theory is strangely silent about credit and leverage. But it still rests, at least implicitly, on a theory about the relationship of credit and inflation, which goes back to the Swedish economist of the turn of the 19th and 20th centuries, Knut Wicksell. Knut Wicksell, in a very important book called also Interest and Prices, noted the ability of private commercial banks to create credit, money, and purchasing power. And he therefore worried, well, what's to stop them producing too much credit, money, and purchasing power? And he convinced himself that they would not create too much credit, money, and purchasing power as long as central banks set market interest rates in line with what he called the natural interest rate, which is the marginal productivity of capital in the real economy. He argued that if central banks set market rates below the natural rate, there would be an incentive to borrow more and more money and the economy would get over-leveraged. But as long as the market rate was in line with the natural rate, all would be well. He then said, however, that of course the natural rate cannot be observed. So central banks cannot follow a simple rule of keep the market rate equal to the interest rate, to the natural rate. But what they can do is to set interest rates so as to achieve low and stable inflation, confident that that will only be achieved if the market rate is in line with the unobserved natural rate. So you run the logic the other way around. You use interest rates to achieve low and stable inflation, and you know that in order to achieve that, it must be the case that what's going on in the credit markets is fine. And that then justifies a point of view that says we don't need to pay attention to credit and to leverage as things in itself. So finance theory assumed that rising leverage, financial deepening as it was called, was in general good. Modern monetary theory believed that it was, broadly speaking, neutral in macroeconomic terms, but optimal because finance theory said so. But both of those conclusions rested, I want to suggest, on dangerously mistaken assumptions. If you pick up almost any economic textbook, or even advanced macro analysis of the financial system, and read what they say about the banking system, they say the following thing. They say that banks take money from savers, probably households, and lend it to entrepreneurs stroke businesses to fund capital investment projects, thus allocating available savings between alternative investments. That's what the textbooks say. Unfortunately, as a description of what modern banks do, that is fictional and dangerously wrong. Banks do not just take existing money and lend it on to borrowers. They create money, credit money, and purchasing power. When they credit to somebody a loan, they create money on their liability side. They create money that does not previously exist. And most of that money in modern economies is not lent to entrepreneurs stroke businesses to fund new capital investment projects. Now, of course, some of it could be lent to entrepreneurs businesses to fund capital investment projects. That's the first line at the top of that. That is part of what the banking system does. They lend money. It could be to real estate developers who are actually constructing new real estate. It could be non-real estate businesses. It could be human capital. It could be machinery. Part of what they do is clearly lending money to fund capital investment. But modern banking systems do two other things as well. First of all, they lend money to people to increase consumption. They lend consumer credit. Now, that may be welfare maximizing. It may usefully enable the person who borrows to smooth their consumption across their life cycle within the constraints of their permanent income. But it has nothing whatsoever to do with the mobilization of investment or the allocation of capital between alternative investment projects, which is what the textbooks tell us banks do. And thirdly, what banks do is to lend money to finance assets that already exist, existing assets. They can lend money, for instance, to private equity operators to leverage up against the purchase of an existing company with no increase in capital investment. But above all, they can lend money to people to buy existing real estate. And the core of what banks predominantly do in modern economies is lend money to people to finance a competition between them for the ownership of already existing real estate. That is what banks actually do. Now, the next chart shows the figures for the UK. This totals to about 1.7 trillion of bank lending in the UK. And you can see it divided between unsecured personal loans, residential mortgage, commercial real estate, and other corporate. You cannot precisely line up these categories with the three conceptual categories I showed on the previous chart. A residential mortgage might support either the purchase of an asset that already exists, or it might indirectly produce investment in actual new construction. Lending against real estate is often used as the real estate is used as collateral for something which is flowing into real new capital investment outside real estate. So the mapping is not perfect. But what is clear from this chart is that the vast majority of lending in the UK was residential mortgages. And I can tell you that the vast majority of that before the crisis had very little to do with new residential real estate construction. The UK, unlike Spain and Ireland, had a credit and asset price real estate boom before the crisis, but we did not have a construction boom. That's different from Spain and Ireland. Our boom was almost entirely in the price of already existing real estate. As for the percentage of this lending, which is about lending to businesses other than in the commercial real estate business, that is less than about 15% or so of total lending out of the UK banking system. Now, I know what people are going to think now. They're going to think, oh, well, that's the UK. We all know that the UK is mad about property. That's one of the things we always know. But the fact is, it isn't just the UK. The following chart is taken from a very fine piece of work by Oscar Jorda, Maurice Schullerich, and Alan Taylor, who have looked at the pattern of lending out of banking systems over the last 140 years, going back to 1870 for 17 major advanced economies. And what they document since the mid-20th century is a relentless increase in the share of bank lending which goes against real estate. And the way they sum up their conclusions is as follows. With very few exceptions, they say, the bank's primary business did indeed consist of non-mortgage lending to companies in 1928 and even as late as 1970. But by 2007, banks in most countries had turned primarily into real estate lenders. So the intermediation of household savings for productive investment in the business sector, which is again and again and again the standard textbook description of what the financial sector does, now constitutes only a very minor share of the business of banking today. So our textbooks are wrong, which suggests that at very least we ought to change our textbooks. But we also need to recognize that lending against real estate, and in particular real estate which is in inelastic supply, has powerful implications which are not at all well captured in Wicksell's idea of a relationship between the market rate of interest and the natural rate of interest. Because at the core of financial and macroeconomic instability in advanced economies lies a relationship between increases in credit and increases in asset prices, and above all, real estate. In the upswing of the cycle, increased credit extended drives up the asset prices of assets which are in scarce supply. And the crucial thing here is that desirable real estate is in scarce supply because everybody wants to live in the same part of town and everybody wants to put their office or their hotel in the same part of town. So it's in scarce supply. If you have increased credit extended against something which is in inelastic supply, you get increased asset prices, which then generate both in the minds of borrowers and of lenders the belief that more borrowing and more lending is a good thing, and which generates more net worth of borrowers and lenders so that they have the capacity to borrow more and lend more. In the inside circle, increased asset prices generate expectations of future asset price increases. They increase the net worth of borrowers who are therefore able to and demand more credit. And on the outside, increased asset prices drive for a period of time low credit losses, high bank profits, high confidence, increased capital base, favorable assessments of credit, and therefore more lending. Until, of course, the system runs into the downswing and then in the red cycle goes into reverse. And because of these cycles, the relationship between credit and real estate is not just part of the story of financial and macroeconomic stability in advanced economies. It is again and again and again pretty much the whole story. That has been well documented by Claudio Borio of the BIS. If you look at financial cycles and financial crises and post-crisis recessions, look again and again at credit and asset prices, but above all, real estate prices. That is the story of Japan in the 1980s and 90s. That is the story of the Scandinavian commercial real estate bust of the early 1990s. That is the story again with the real estate bust in the US, Spain, Ireland, and the UK in the latest crisis. So we need macro and monetary policy levers to lean against these cycles. But my argument is that we need to focus not just on the financial system, but we need to look at the overall macroeconomic impact of these cycles. And to understand them well, I think there are three things that we need to understand. The first is that real estate is bound to become a dominant form of wealth and therefore a dominant source of risk in advanced economies. It would be so even without leverage, but leverage makes it even more so. That's point one, I'll come to that. Secondly, that the real economy debt overhang is the crucial driver of why we have suffered a post-crisis recession and not an impaired banking system. And I'll explain what I mean by that. And third, that excessive credit growth may never, never, never result in excessive inflation, but can have serious effects. And that is immensely important for what was wrong with our pre-crisis monetary theory. The first point then, real estate will dominate as a sort of risk in advanced economies. Thomas Piketty has rightly been lauded for this extraordinary book, Capital in the 21st Century, which has documented a quite dramatic increase in the ratio of wealth to income which has occurred in advanced economies over the last 50 years. In about 1950, typical wealth-to-income ratios in advanced economies were about 200 to 300%. They are now about 5 or 6. That is Piketty's fundamental fact, which he then tries to explain. But what is really startling when you look at Piketty's figures in detail is that the vast majority, and in some countries, all of that increase in the wealth-to-income ratio is explained by one thing, which is the increase in the value of real estate. If you look here in Britain, you can see that in terms of the increase in the wealth-to-income ratio that has occurred since 1950, it is the green bit which dominates, and the green bit is real estate. And within there, again, it's a very fine article, this by Maurice Schullerich and colleagues, within there, it is land that values. That value of real estate has not gone up because we've constructed more bricks and mortar. 80% of that increase in the value of real estate relative to income is explained by the increase in the value of locationally specific urban land. And this is true of France. It's even to a degree true of Germany, least true of Germany, dramatically true of Australia, of Canada, of the US. This is a general pattern. Why does this occur? Why do we have an increasing importance of real estate? I think it's important that we understand three factors at work. The first is that the demand for locationally specific real estate is a high income elasticity category of demand. As we get richer, there are some things where we do not want proportionally more of. For most of us, there is a limit to the number of washing machines we want to own. You know, one or two might be enough. Categories of expenditure such as food or clothing display income elasticity less than one. When the income goes up, you spend a bit more on that, but you don't spend as much as your increase in income. But the desire to compete with one another for the right to live in the nice part of town, or to stay in the hotel which is on the beach, not a mile away from the beach, or on the piste, not a mile away from the piste, that turns out to be a very high income elasticity category of demand. And that means that locationally specific real estate would go up in value relative to income, even if the other factors were not at work. But the second factor in the bottom left is that once people realize that that is the case, once they observe that real estate prices tend to go up faster than income, they perceive real estate to be an attractive asset class, which they buy not because they want to actually live in it, but because it is a store of wealth and hopefully a source of capital gain. Now, we see that at the top end of the income and wealth distribution, where if you go and look late at night at the luxury flat development in the middle of London, One Knightsbridge, you will see almost no lights on at night, because flats, apartments in One Knightsbridge are not actually bought to live in. They are bought as sheer tokens of wealth as a matter of appreciation. But this effect is far wider than this, because to the extent that any individual thinks, I'd better buy a house earlier than I otherwise would, because otherwise I'm going to lose out and be squeezed out by appreciation of price, they are thinking of housing as an asset class. So the fact that we think about leverage, real estate as an asset class, also increases the price of real estate. But then we have leverage. Because banks are able, unless we constrain them, to create infinite supplies of credit and private money. And the easiest thing seen from a bank of what to lend against is real estate, because it's collateral. You don't have to do complicated analysis of business projects. You just have to think about the loan to value. The net effect is, when you put those three facts together and ally them with an inelastic supply of locationally desirable land, we have a somewhat indeterminate, volatile, and rising price. We have an instability at the very center of the modern economies. So that was point one. Why does real estate increase in importance? My second point was to assert that the fundamental reason why we have why recovery from the crisis has been so weak and slow is the high level of credit. I began with that assertion. Now let me return to it. I want to say that ahead of the crisis, we should have known that the increase in leverage mattered, because we had a canary in the mine, and that canary was called Japan. In the 1980s, Japan had one of the biggest green cycles, going back to my chart earlier, that we've ever seen. Credit against real estate, increases in real estate prices, price of central Tokyo real estate up by 80%, bank balance sheets doubling, tripling as those prices went up. Then, when the confidence broke and we went into the red cycle, we ended up with what Richard Koo has called a balance sheet recession. And I do think that Richard Koo's book on the holy grail of modern macroeconomics, Lessons from Japan's Great Recession, I think is a very important book. He basically says that what happens in the 1990s of Japan can be summed up on this chart. The red line is the financial balance of private non-financial corporates. Up until the late 1980s, they are borrowing money. Even if they are electronics companies or car companies, they're borrowing money to participate in real estate speculation. They are borrowing money to do commercial real estate developments. And they then have a negative financial balance. As you can see, the red line is below the zero line. But what happens when the prices begin to fall and the confidence crumbles, and prices in Japan fall by 80%, having gone up by four times. They go up by four times and then they come down by 80%. What happens is that the private non-financial sector becomes absolutely determined to pay back its debts, and it swings into a financial surplus where, whenever it gets profit, it is not focused on new investment, but is focused on paying back existing debt. That then inevitably drives the economy into a recession. Tax revenues fall and public expenditures go up on unemployment, and that drives the green line, which is government, from being in surplus to being a negative. That, Koo argues, I think quite rightly, was not only natural, but actually useful, because the deleveraging of the private sector was offset by the deficits, the stimulus effect of the public sector, public deficits, but with the inevitable consequence that while the private sector slowly delevered, see the red line, that is Japanese non-financial corporate debt as a percent of GDP slowly coming down, the public sector debt, the green line, relentlessly and relentlessly increases and is now at about 230% debt to GDP and still rising. The problem we have is that once we have created in the private sector a large amount of debt as a result of those cycles of credit and asset prices, we really don't know how to get rid of it. We know how to shift it around the economy, to shift it from the private sector to the public sector, but we don't know how to get rid of it. And the pattern over the last 5-6 years, which you can see here in the figures for Spain, for the US and the UK, is that for every percentage point reduction in debt to GDP of households or of companies, we have had a more than percentage increase in public sector debt to GDP, which is the blue bottom line on this chart. We have simply shifted the debt around. We haven't got rid of it. And that indeed, as the latest Geneva report on the world economy makes clear, is what has happened at the overall global level. You can see it here for the developed markets. You can see, leave out for the moment the red line, which is financials. That's to do with internal things within the financial system. The total leverage, public and private combined, is the green line, has continued to go up. And at the overall level of the overall world, what we've had is the world leverage going to go up as developed markets have gone up less slowly than before, but have been offset by an increase in emerging markets. What has happened after the recession, having created, as per my first chart, a very large amount of private credit in advanced economies before the crisis, is once we are in that situation, we know how to shift it around, but we don't know how to get rid of it without spinning our economies into deep recessions. We need to shift it to the public sector in order to offset private sector deleveraging with public sector deficits, or we need to offset deleveraging in one country with leveraging elsewhere. This is the chart which I use to tease German friends. And the question I want to ask my German friends is, when are you going to get embarrassed by your out-of-control credit-fueled boom? And of course, Germans say, we're not credit-fueled. We're one country in the world which has been deleveraging. But the point is, Germany has been dependent on a credit-fueled boom. Before the crisis in the Eurozone, it was dependent on the credit-fueled boom in Spain and Italy and Greece. Since the crisis, it has been dependent on the credit-fueled boom in China. If it had not been for the fact that after the crisis, the Chinese authorities, worried by the impact of the global recession on Chinese employment, if it had not been for the fact that they had then stimulated credit as massively as possible, then the German economy would not have been able to grow and would not have been able to deleverage. And indeed, it is the turning of the Chinese leverage cycle over the last 6 months which is really now pushing the German economy into much slower growth. So the crucial problem here is not that the financial system itself is impaired and unable to provide new credit supply, but that once you have excessive leverage, over-leveraged households and companies do not wish to borrow, are determined to pay down debt, and are cutting investment and consumption in an attempt to do so. That has been illustrated, I think, brilliantly in one of the best new business and economic books of this year, which is by Atif Mian and Amir Sufi. It's called House of Debt. And on the basis of a meticulous analysis in the US of what caused the decline in consumption, they are able to illustrate on a county-by-county basis that it is not driven by the inability of banks to lend money because the financial system is impaired. It's driven by the fact that once you have over-leveraged households who have borrowed too much money, they are determined to pay down their debt. And that, I suggest, is also true in the Eurozone. Eurozone policy from about 2011 on was continually publicly predicated on the following assumption. It was, we've got an impaired banking system, we've had a financial crisis, because people don't trust the banks cannot lend enough money, because we have a fragmentation of the European capital market, the cost of credit is high in Spain and Italy, we've got to fix the banking system, then there will be enough credit to the real economy. Well, in fact, between 2011 and earlier this year, interest rates on credit in Spain, in Italy, in Ireland came down dramatically. They came down to very low levels indeed. But there was not then an increase in lending to the real economy. And indeed, the big test of whether the key problem was supply or demand was when the ECB, in a further attempt to execute this strategy of, if only we have credit supply, everything will be okay, when it, in the summer, launched the targeted LTROs and said to the banking system, borrow from me at 0.1%, and here's 400 billion euros available to borrow at 0.1%, the European banking system in September chose to borrow only 80 billion of the 400 billion available. I think we are staring at the fact that our fundamental problem in the US, in Europe, as indeed in Japan in the 1990s, is an overleveraged real economy which is attempting to delever, a private sector economy attempting to delever, and is far less than we have suggested, an impaired banking system unable to lend money. That has two implications for policy which are highly relevant both in general and for the challenges of constructing sound foundations in Europe. The first is that we face extremely difficult choices as we attempt to escape from post-crisis recession. Because in this environment where the private sector is over-leveraged and attempting to deleverage, it appears that all our policy levers are blocked. The obvious thing, the thing that stimulates the economy immediately, might seem to be to run fiscal deficits. And I don't think any economist argues that the first order impact of a fiscal deficit is stimulative to the economy. The problem is that that then produces an increase in the stock of public debt, which then raises issues about debt sustainability, which then suggests that we need also to have austerity and deleveraging in the public sector, by which time we've got the private and the public sector both trying to delever at the same time, and we have an even more extreme impact on demand. So what do? We think, well, instead of that, we'll have extremely loose monetary policy. We'll cut interest rates to the zero bound, and then we'll do quantitative easing to bring down the long-term rates as well as the short-term rates. The only trouble with that is, for a long period of time, it doesn't have much effect at all, because if people are over-leveraged, they don't want to borrow, even if you want to lend them to the square root of nothing. Well, eventually they do. Get it low enough, get it negative, eventually they'll borrow money. But as the IMF and its latest global financial stability report says, that has a negative effect. Because when you lend money, when the central bank says, here's money for nothing, you will probably produce complicated financial engineering speculations which create risk in the financial economy somewhat earlier than you actually produce a real economy effect. And when you do produce a real economy effect, you have to deal with the following paradox, that your strategy for dealing with the problems of excessive debt is to persuade people to borrow more debt. Your answer to this hangover that we're suffering from is a very stiff drink. So we face, in the post-crisis debt overhang, very big problems. It seems that all our policy levers are blocked, which suggests that the other big challenge is that we need to stop excessive debt growing in the first place. We need policies to lean against excessive debt creation. But that raises a question. Before the crisis, the theory was, as long as we have low and stable inflation, the financial system and the macroeconomy will be okay. But actually what happened is we had all this credit, but it didn't show up as warning signs to central banks on the inflation monitor, but it still produced excessive debt and a debt overhang. So how is it that you can have rapid credit growth without an increase in inflation? After all, think of the following stylized fact. It's broadly speaking true. In the major advanced economies for 20 years before the financial crisis, private credit grew at about 10 to 15% per annum. Nominal GDP grew at about 5% per annum. That, of course, is why leverage increased. Your numerator was going up faster than your denominator. But why was it possible to have continual 10 to 15% credit growth without that showing up in a rapid growth rate of nominal GDP and thus of inflation? The answer, I suggest, takes us back to those three categories of credit creation. If all credit creation did what our textbooks say it did and lent money for new investment, then it would probably be the case that, broadly speaking, more credit would show up in inflation. It's not absolutely clear. There's some arguments in Hayek and Schumpeter as to why that might not be the case, at least for a period of time. But you would have thought that, broadly speaking, credit would mean that somebody's out there buying investment goods, and if there was too much credit, there would be too much purchase, and then there would be inflation. But now think about the other two categories of credit. The second one is finance for consumption. Well, you might think that that's the same, that if you lend money to somebody to consume more, then that will stimulate nominal demand, and if it's excessive, produce inflation. But the reason why it might not be is that if it's occurring alongside a very big increase in inequality. One of the features of richer people, apart from spending all that money on real estate, is that they also tend to save more. They have a higher marginal propensity to save and a lower marginal propensity to consume than poorer people. So in a society where we have a very big increase in inequality, which has been a feature of the advanced economies for the last 30 years, if nothing else happened, we might have a problem of deficient demand because money would be piling up in the hands of richer people who want to save it and who want to save it in excess of the investment needs of the economy, while poorer people who do want to consume would be constrained by low income. But there's something that can stop that effect occurring, and that is essentially for the rich people to lend the poorer people money. And one of the things we have had over the last 30 years is the steady accumulation of financial assets by the better half of the population, actually by the top 5%, and an increase of debt levels in the middle and the bottom end of the distribution. So the increase in credit for consumption has been necessary for us to maintain an adequate rate of nominal demand in the face of an increase in inequality. But most importantly, where we have credit to finance existing asset purchase, it's important to realize that we have no necessary impetus to nominal demand. When a bank lends one of you money to buy a house off me, the first order effect of that is simply that there are more credit balances, you've borrowed more money, there are more money balances, I have more money, and the price of houses go up. It has no first order effect on nominal demand, on actual consumption or investment. It may have indirect effects through what are called wealth effects and Tobin Q effects, but there is no necessary reason to believe that those are fully proportional to the increase in credit which first occurs. So when most credit is extended against existing real estate and ultimately against the inelastic supply land on which the real estate sits, we can have very significant increases in credit, in money, in asset prices, which create a vulnerability to crisis, post-crisis overhang, deleveraging and deflation, but which never show up in inflation. Now, what that means is that monetary aggregates matter. Total balance sheets matter. We should care about the size of bank balance sheets relative to GDP. We should care about credit relative to GDP. But they matter for a completely different reason than monetarist theory suggests. They do not matter because money, the liability side of the bank balance sheets, is a good forward predictor of inflation. They matter because credit, the asset side of the bank balance sheets, is a good forward indicator of excessive leverage, crisis, post-crisis debt overhang, and as a result, deflation. What does that imply in general for the frameworks that we need for the future? It means that we cannot have just one objective and one instrument. We cannot simply say low and stable inflation is sufficient, because credit and asset price cycles and rising leverage can produce macroeconomic instability while never producing excessive inflation. Nor can we use interest rates to slow down these credit and asset price cycles. Now, you could accept the top half of that assertion, but still disagree with the bottom half of this slide. And broadly speaking, this is the position of somebody like Bill White, who was formerly chief economist at the BIS. Bill would say, absolutely right about the top half. We should have cared about those increases in credit and leverage. But what we ought to have done in advance of the crisis was set interest rates higher than inflation targeting suggested appropriate in order to slow down the credit and asset price boom. The reason why that doesn't work is what I call the heterogeneity, the variety of the interest rate elasticity of response in different sectors of the economy. Let me try and sum that up in simple terms. When you have a real estate boom going, when borrowers and lenders have ended up believing that there is likely to be an increase in real estate prices of 10 or 15% per annum, then increasing the interest rate from 4 to 4.5 to 5%, a sort of typical thing that central banks do, is not going to make a blind bit of difference to that real estate boom and the credit that goes with it. But raising the interest rates from 5 to 10 is probably going to slow down the real economy and investment to businesses and entrepreneurs to fund new investment long before it slows down the real estate boom. And the test of this has been Sweden over the last 3 years. From 2011 to 2013, the Riksbank raised interest rates above that which would have been suggested by inflation targeting in an attempt to slow down a credit and asset price boom in Stockholm. It was almost completely ineffective at slowing down the credit and asset price boom in Stockholm, but has tipped the Swedish economy into deflation and very slow growth. What that implies is that we need a wider set of objectives in public policy and a wider set of tools. But I'm not going to go in detail through those. You can very quickly scan what those objectives are and what those tools are, because I want to end with some very brief comments about the specific implications of that within Europe. I've suggested that one of the big features, the fundamental problem that existed before the crisis and which has driven the slow and weak post-crisis recovery, is excessive leverage. We saw that in the Eurozone before the crisis. In some countries in the Eurozone, it wasn't private credit, it was public credit. So you have to add that to the story. In Greece and in Italy, it was excessive private credit, private borrowing, which drove total leverage up to dangerous levels. But in Spain, in Ireland, in Portugal, Spain and Ireland in particular, it was primarily private credit. Indeed, Spain and Ireland, let's be absolutely clear, had collapsing public debt levels before the crisis. People were talking about the fact that Ireland would probably pay back all of its debt by 2012, so rapidly was it reducing its public debt burdens. Those private credit booms in Spain, in Ireland and Portugal were also matched with large cross-border capital flows. To a degree, Spanish and Irish credit booms were financed by those good, frugal, high-saving Germans. And you can see that, sorry, wrong chart. You can see that, I want to move on to this one, in Eurozone current account deficits. The Eurozone current account deficits, which must be the flip side of capital flows. We had some areas of Europe saving lots of money, Germany in particular, but large current account deficits emerging in the periphery. Now, there's an interesting point here about how we should think about capital flows. Because in the pre-crisis orthodoxy, just as there tended to be an entirely benign attitude towards financial deepening and the increase in credit as a percent of GDP, there also tended to be a completely benign attitude to free capital flows across the world, and for the same reasons. The reason being that it was assumed that those capital flows would be funding useful capital investment. And indeed, if you go back to the debates about launching the Eurozone in the early 1990s, there's a very interesting document to read in retrospect. It was produced by the European Commission, and it's called One Market, One Money. And One Market, One Money says, why will the Eurozone be good for the productivity of Europe? It'll be good because we will remove the barriers to capital flow, the exchange rate risk barriers to capital flow, and capital will flow to the areas which have lower productivity to fund new capital investment, which will drive those peripheral areas more rapidly up to the productivity of the lever, of the leading companies. What is interesting is that that prediction that the Eurozone would lead to capital flows came absolutely right. And the capital flows are the flip side of these current account deficits. The problem was that the capital flows were not at all the capital flows which had been predicted. Just like most bank credit does not flow to fund new capital investment by businesses and entrepreneurs, most of those capital flows did not flow into capital investment in Ireland and Spain, which drove them up to European leading levels of productivity. It gave an extra twist to that green cycle of credit and real estate booms. What that meant, of course, is that there was also another shift which occurred, which is that when the crisis broke, we ceased having those increase in private inflows into Greece, Spain and Portugal, or Ireland or Italy, which are shown in the red on this chart. And again, we had to socialize the flows through the target two balances of the European Central Bank. It was another of those shifts where, first of all, the private sector does too much, and then the public sector has to take the strain. So what then does this imply for Eurozone policy? I think we have to understand that the Eurozone faces the generic problems that I have talked about, the problems of excessive private credit and the need to have a wider set of public policy tools to deal with them, but it is struggling with them within a particular institutional setup, an institutional setup of one currency and multiple, what Charles Goodhart calls, sub-sovereign states, states which do not have their own currency. And that creates the vulnerabilities which are inherent within the general story that I've told, but multiplied many times. Those vulnerabilities exist, first of all, because it's very difficult to have the fiscal offset, which was so crucial in Japan. It's very difficult to have the fiscal offset because if the fiscal levers exist at national level, not at the federal level, and if national debt is perceived to carry a default risk, in a way that that UK debt doesn't, and US debt doesn't, and Japanese debt doesn't, then it means that we are constrained in terms of being able to have the fiscal offsets to private sector deleveraging which work in other economies. That implies, and I will finish now because I'm out of town, that for the Eurozone to work, we are going to have to really fundamentally change its structure with a banking union, federal level deposit insurance, euro bonds, significant but still limited federal fiscal budget, but macroprudential levers still deployable at national level. I'm out of time, I'll have to leave you to ask questions about that. But it also leaves us with a very major problem about what do we do about the rise in the debt which we have faced. Let me tell you what I think is going to happen in Japan and then simply pose the question for Europe. Japan, I want to end with, is not going to repay its debt in the normal sense of the word repay. If you believe that Japan, having run these large deficits, is going to turn round and have a large fiscal surplus and pay back this debt, you are deluding yourself. And the scenario set out in the IMF Fiscal Monitor, which shows the Japanese primary surplus going from minus 6 to plus 6 over the next 6 years, and then Japan paying down its debt in the subsequent 15, that is delusional. It is not going to occur. What will happen in Japan is one of three things, the bottom three on this. They will not be able slowly to erode that debt via growth. They will have to write it off and restructure it, or they will need an almost perpetual period of interest rates below inflation and nominal GDP, or, and most likely, they will permanently monetize that debt. They will turn it into money. The big question for Europe is, where does Europe stand? And I want to end, and I suggested we were going to end with Götterdämmerung and not Fledermaus, with suggesting that Europe is in the same position. It has created an accumulation of leverage, originally in the private sector primarily, now also in the public sector, that it cannot simply grow out of, and that it will have to consider either write-off or permanent monetization to escape from the problem which was fundamentally created by excessive credit creation in the private sector before the crisis. Thank you very much.
So thanks a lot for this very stimulating and very interesting lecture. There's now still room for questions. I can imagine that many people have many questions. We can only take a few. Are there people who want to? Here's a question in the fourth row and then over there, the second one.
Hi, if I listen correctly, I think you managed to finish your talk without mentioning technology. So I was wondering if you can say something about how technology, what is happening there, intersects the speech that you just gave us. Thank you.
Okay. I think technology, perhaps oddly, is vitally important to this story, both in relation to inequality and to the increasing importance of real estate. I think one of the finest books on the impact of technology which is occurring at the moment is Erik Brynjolfsson's and Andrew McAfee's The Second Machine Age. In that, Brynjolfsson and McAfee argue that fundamentally, in terms of the impact of information and communication technology, you ain't seen nothing yet. That we are on the verge of achievements in robotization, in automation, which are going to enable us to automate all sorts of functions in our economy which we have not previously been able to automate. But they also argue, and I think correctly, that it is highly likely that the impact of this acceleration of the impact of information and communication technology will be to increase yet further the inequality which is afflicting advanced economies. both at the top end and at the bottom end. At the top end, because there's something about information and communication technology deriving from its combination of truly dramatic collapses in hardware cost and the fact that software is replicable at zero marginal cost. When you put those two together, there is extraordinary capacity from ICT to create wealth with very little capital investment and far faster and on far larger scale than existed in, for instance, the electromechanical and early mechanical stages of the Industrial Revolution. Think about the following fact. Facebook floated with an equity market value of $170 billion. My calculation is that if you try and work out how much investment went into Facebook, in the classic economist sense of people having to devote their activity to build a machine, in this case software, by devoting resource not to current consumption but to capital, it was about 5,000 software man engineers, engineer man years. 5,000 software engineer man years, 170 billion of equity market value. That is a relationship completely different from that which existed when Henry Ford had to build his factories before he could deliver the Model T Ford, and people had to build steel foundries before they could build the machinery which went into it. So there's something about information and communication technology which produces huge wealth at the top end. It automates away low-skilled jobs at the bottom end and reduces the equilibrium real wage rate of low-skilled people. And it also may mean, I think probably does mean, that the total amount of capital investment needed to drive productivity is probably declining. There's quite a lot of signs that the average price of new capital goods in the sense of plant and machinery is declining relative to current prices. All of which means that there's actually even less for the banking system to do in lending money to manufacturers to buy plant and equipment, because the value of that plant and equipment, if it is software intensive, is falling in value. And all of which means that actually we're probably going to devote still more of our resources to competing with one another for the ownership of locationally desirable land. I call this the high-tech, high-touch paradox, that the more our economy becomes intensive in that high-tech world of information and communications technology, the more that relative value in the economy probably shifts to the most physical thing of all, which is urban land. So I think information and communication technology is a very important part of this macro story, but perhaps in some slightly paradoxical ways.
Question over there, and then the third one.
Thank you, sir, for your analysis of balance sheets and their forecasting capacity, of, especially on the asset side of the balance sheet. Would you care to comment on the central bank balance sheets also? Is there something you can read or forecast out of the central bank balance sheets that you have done for the private banking balance sheets?
Once private sector has created a large amount of leverage, we tend to get a variety of different shifts of the aggregates rather than disappearance of the aggregates. Those shifts can be simply a shift from private leverage to public leverage, but they can also be the step beyond that, which is an increase in the central bank balance sheet, which is essentially, when it's really large, usually comes from the central bank buying the public debt. Or it can come, as I rather quickly flipped over, within the Eurozone, that private capital flows are substituted with target two balances within the ECB's inter-country balance sheets. So in the fundamental phenomenon is, once you've created too much private credit, it tends to just simply shift around the system. How should we think about those central bank balance sheets? Well, let's look at Japan. Japan has public debt to GDP, gross level about 230%. When you net out things like bits which are owned by the Social Security Fund, maybe now 140, 150%, but it's still it's still very high. Of that 140% GDP net Japanese public debt, I think the latest figure is about a third of that, 60% of GDP, is now owned by the Bank of Japan, the Central Bank of Japan. And indeed, the Bank of Japan is now on a quantitative easing program where it fundamentally is continuing to buy all incremental Japanese government debt. It is buying all of it. How should we think about that? Well, I said earlier, I finished by saying that I can see no circumstances in which Japanese government debt will be repaid in the normal sense of the word repay, i.e. go from a primary fiscal deficit to a primary surplus and repay the debt. Nor can I see any scenario in which the Bank of Japan, having put all this debt on balance sheet, is at some stage going to sell it off. The purported proposition of quantitative easing is that it works through long-term interest rates and asset prices, but that it is not a monetization of government debt. And the reason why it isn't a monetization of government debt is that having bought it, we will eventually sell it back. The Bank of Japan will not sell that debt. It will eventually permanently monetize Bank of Japan, Japanese government debt, and should do so. Given the severity of the depth of the problem which Japan is now in, the optimal solution, bluntly, is for the government and the Bank of Japan to sit down with the Japanese people one day and say the following. You know that 60% of GDP which is owed from the government of Japan to the Bank of Japan? Well, here's an interesting thing. The government of Japan owns the Bank of Japan, so at the consolidated balance sheet level, it doesn't exist. Not only should that occur, a lot of people may, particularly here in Middle Europe, disagree with the fact that that should occur, so I won't take a bet on that, but I will take a bet that it will occur, right? I will take a bet with anybody. Japan will not repay its debt within the normal sense of the word repay, nor will the Bank of Japan's balance sheet shrink. And by the way, we've seen this before. If you look at how did America pay for the Second World War, the calculation which is set out by Milton Friedman and Anna Schwartz in their great book, Monetary: A History of the US, is that they paid for the Second World War roughly a third by increasing taxation, a third by issuing public debt which was actually repaid, and a third by issuing public debt which was permanently bought by the Federal Reserve. From 1942 to 1951, the Federal Reserve stood ready to buy whatever debt the federal government issued if it was needed to do that to keep interest rates at 2%. So whatever federal deficit the government had, the Federal Reserve bought it. In 1951, it stopped doing that. It said, we don't need to do that any longer. We can go back to the normal policies by which we run a country in normal times. We don't need to monetize any longer. But if you look at the Federal Reserve balance sheet after 1951, it doesn't shrink. It simply stops growing. That balance sheet asset is permanently on there. Now, what they didn't do is do an accounting entry to write it off because they didn't need to because the debt wasn't so big. But when you have to monetize a deficit to get out of the depth of the hole we are now in, and let me be clear, I think the Eurozone and Japan are in very deep economic holes, then you have to consider extreme policy measures such as permanent monetization.